with the odd slide thrown in. But as she proudly sang in Stephen Sondheim's Follies, and is the title of her book, I'm Still Here. And to prove that she hasn't changed her wicked ways one iota with I Wanna Be Evil, Eartha Kitt.
I've posed for pictures with ivory soap. I've petted stray dogs and shied clear of dope. My smile is brilliant. My glance is tender. But I'm noted most for my unspoiled gender. I've been made Miss Rheingold, though I never touch beer. And I'm the person to whom they say, you're sweet, my dear. The only etchings I've seen have been behind glass. And the closest I've been to a bar was at ballet class. Prim and proper. The girl who's never been cased. Well, I'm tired of being pure and not chaste. Something that seeks to level up. I wanna go to the devil. I wanna be evil. I wanna spit taps. I wanna be evil and cheat at chaps. I wanna be wicked. I wanna tell lies. I wanna be mean and throw my pies. I want to wake up in the morning with that dark brown taste. Dissipation in my face. I wanna be evil. I wanna be mad. But more than that, I wanna be bad. I wanna be evil and a trumpet ace, just to see my partner's face. I wanna be nasty. I wanna be cruel. I wanna be daring. I wanna shoot pool. And in the theater, I want to change my seat just so I can step on everybody's feet. I want to be evil. I want to hurt flies. I want to sing songs like the guy who cries. I want to be horrid. I want to drink booze. And whatever I've got, I'm eager to lose. Just as mean and evil as I can be.
You just threw it there, didn't you?
Oh, yes, thank you, darling. I brought it
thank
to you.
Thank you.
It suits. I want to be evil.
Wow.
Oh, I love the way. I wish I could do that. Do you have to. Kind of. It's a sophisticated gargle, that, isn't it? Yeah. You're always perceived as a wicked female, aren't you? You've always encouraged that image. I mean, you like that image.
I don't really think I really thought of it. I think that when I started to sing songs like that, it was RCA who pushed those particular kind of songs out on the public, so that's how I...
Because you're not a wicked woman.
No, I'm not, but who's going to believe me?
Nobody. Nobody, no, but I'm reading your book, you know, your name, you've associated with people like Porfirio Rubirosa, one of the great lovers of all time,
yeah.
With Orson Welles, yeah. Who's not known for being quiet. And yet, they never laid a glove on you, did they?
No, that's right. I was very young, and they had tremendous respect for a very young girl.
Well, that's nice, but it's not that you're... Because, you see, as you say, you seem to be wicked. And you're not a tease, are you?
Oh, dear.
Yes,
oh,
no. No, there you are, you see. There you are, you're doing it now. You're doing it.
Well, Mr. Morgan, tell me, how wicked do you think?
Well, I'm just thinking. See, when the program is over, I might be encouraged by this to rush into your dressing room and fling myself upon you. And you'd say, you close the door on my face, because that's what you do. You're a tease.
You've never tried it, so I don't know if I would.
No, be honest, now. Do you think you're a tease?
Yes. And you want to know something, in all honesty?
Yeah.
You're one of the few people who accept me teasing them.
Why, what happens?
I don't know, but they think that you are, I don't know, inhibited or something.
No, I'm not.
And I never found that.
No, I've never found
that. I never found that, Mr. Morgan. I never found you to be inhibited at all.
Well.
Now I'm waiting for you to open the door after the show.
Right, well, look, thank you all for coming. Now, there's the two sides of Eartha Kitt, if I say, from the book, it seems. Mm. There is the very vulnerable, innocent young girl who was abused, as you say, and rejected. And then there is the extrovert person. When does one character stop and the other take over? Are you conscious of the two sides of your character?
Very often I am, and then sometimes I'm not. And when I catch myself realizing that I have reverted back into being Eartha Mae,
This is Eartha Mae, which is what your name was when you were very poor, and your mother actually passed you on to somebody else.
Yes, she gave me away to a family that would that eventually wound up using me as a work mule. And my mother gave me to this family because the man that she wanted to marry said, I don't want that yellow gal in my house. Which meant being an illegitimate child and also the wrong color. You are not wanted by the blacks, and the whites couldn't care less. So this black family, who had two teenage children, used me as a, whatever they could use me as a working person. And then I was also by the young gentleman in that family.
Are you? How old were you then?
I know people don't believe it when I say I don't know how old I am, but I know somewhere I'm way past 60.
But how old were you then?
Not way past 60, but I'm way past 50. But I was really still about 5-6 years old.
And all that abuse going on.
Yes, and all of that abuse was going on, and I couldn't tell anybody about it because who would have believed me? And the young boy, he was not the nicest kid in the world, and neither was his sister, who also, I didn't know anything about lesbians in those days. And she too tried. And there were times when the whole family was gone into the fields or something like that, harvesting, picking cotton or whatever they were doing, and we were left in the house alone. The two teenagers would tie me in what we call a croaker sack, I think you call it, what potatoes come in.
Yeah.
They would tie the sack around my waist and then tie me to a tree. And with a peach tree switch, they would beat my bottom until I was bleeding, and I only had one thing to wear, and that was also made of potato sacking. And
Well, I can understand how, following something, I mean, several years of that, that is going to mark you for life.
Well, you try not to have it leave a scar on you.
Yeah.
Emotionally or mentally, but of course, and even though the physical scars are gone, and you start talking about it like we are talking about it now, and you try to not get emotional about it, but all of a sudden those feelings do come back. And the idea of them tying me to a tree, and you're not able to escape at all.
Yes, and then you had an auntie, your mother's sister, who looked after you then in New York. Isn't that right? You went to New York to your mother's sister, Auntie Mamie?
Yes, Auntie Mamie.
Did she look after you any better?
No. My aunt was very, very strict. My aunt was a very tall lady. She was about 6 feet tall and also very fair in complexion. She's half Cherokee, very majestic looking. I was deathly afraid of her, even from the sight when I first saw her. I was terribly afraid of her. But she had no children of her own. She was never married. And I think that she brought me up north to New York out of a Christian duty, you know, because she got a letter from the South that told her that if I was not taken away from this family, that they would either starve me to death or beat me to death or work me to death. And therefore, she decided that she would take me on into New York. But she wasn't any better. She was also abusing me.
You ran away from her, too?
Yes, but I think God certainly has his funny ways, you know, because I was trying to get away from her, but where do you go? What do you do? I used to stay away from her as much as I could, and I kept running away. And whenever I had a few pennies, I could... Subway was a nickel, for instance. And I used to get on the subway and ride from one end of Manhattan to the other, hoping that the conductor wouldn't see me, because they used to have conductors on the subways at the time. And then get off on the other end and get back on. And he couldn't see me.
You seem to be...
And just keep riding all night long until daybreak.
Running away from your life.
Well, I don't think I was running away from life. I was running away from rejection. I was running away from not being accepted.
Have you... Has that stayed with you? I mean, do you find that... Is that why you think... Perhaps you're an extrovert, that you're looking for attention, you're looking for affection.
But, Mr. Vaughan, you know something? I'm not an extrovert. I can tease as Eartha Kitt, but as Eartha May, forget it. I'm hiding under the behind the bushes, behind the chairs, behind everything you possibly could... I could possibly find to hide behind. Because I never have been with that kind of security within Eartha May. That makes me feel that she will ever be accepted. I don't think Eartha, in myself, in my subconscious. And when I'm writing the book, when I was writing the book, I realized that more and more. And that's why maybe sometimes I am going around looking like the urchin that I really know I am inside of myself. And not wearing any makeup and not caring about what I look like. That little ugly duckling was always told she's an ugly duckling. Nobody wants you. And she's trying so hard to find somebody that says, Eartha May, it's all right. You want it too. But nobody's done that yet. Maybe I have not given them a chance to do so. I don't know. But she keeps hoping.
But you must, people must have shown you affection and love in your life. Is it that you can't accept it?
The public and my daughter, yes. The public.
Never.
If
never,
it wasn't for the public, a man has always wanted to lay me down, but he never wanted to pick me up. And the men that did have real love and affection for me were the ones that never touched me. That was Orson Welles, Ruby Rosa. And there were a couple of real love, strong love that men have had for me. Two of them, John Barry Ryan III and Othello Jr. But then the mothers step in. And I think very often the mothers, particularly with boys who come from extremely wealthy families and they are the only son, they would rather them marry trash than marry someone of color, no matter how wonderful a person that person of color may be.
You've been a tremendous survivor in the face of things that most people would not have survived. Where do you find happiness?
I have to find it within myself. And the wonderful feeling that you have when you're standing on that stage and that audience gives you that applause and says, Eartha, it's okay. You're still here and we're glad that you're still here. And when I see the young people, particularly today when everybody knows I'm past 50, whatever the number may be, does not seem to matter to them. When I see the people my age who have grown up with me in this business, they're in the audience and they've brought their children and their children's children, believe me, that makes me feel that I really am a worthwhile person. But then it's something else when I go back to the dressing room, because when I take off the makeup and I'm not Eartha Kitt anymore, you say, okay, now.
You're Eartha May.
Yeah, I'm Eartha May again. It becomes a testing ground. And I know that. No matter how hard you try not to, it's still there. I'm not afraid of it. And I'm very glad that I can have the feelings from that urchin. And I'm very glad that I have never tried to cover her up. I'm very glad that she's still a part of me. And I'm very glad that she will always be a part of me. Because she helps me do what she knows I have to do out there on the stage, because there is where my survival is. with that public and with those who know me well enough to realize that Eartha Mae or Kitty, whomever they want to call me, she's okay.
Well, we're very glad that you've revealed so much of yourself and been unafraid to do so. And it's been a great pleasure to talk to you, and thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rogan. It's always a pleasure.
Both sides of Eartha Mae and Eartha Kitt, and our thanks to her. And of course to Linford Christie.